sorry for the delay. We had a power surge. Okay, so one more time. Welcome to the 7th Storm Seminar Series. I'm Charlo Arzadon, and I'm from the Stormwater Planning Unit with the State Water Resources Control Board. In the event of an emergency, exits are in the back, out to my right, head down the staircase, out the main doors, and cross I-10th Street into Cesar Chavez Park. Restrooms are out in the back doors and on my left. This presentation is being recorded and will be posted afterwards on the Storm Seminar webpage at waterboards.ca.gov/storms. Okay, so those watching in, please email your questions to storms@waterboards.ca.gov. The Storm Seminar Series is an effort stemming from State Water Board's strategy to optimize resource management of stormwater, and it supports our mission of advancing the perspective that stormwater is a valuable resource. With that, let me introduce our speakers. Thank you, Nicole, Gary, and Donna.
All right. Good morning, Storms. Thanks for hosting us here today. We're excited to share what we believe is an opportunity to transform the way that we manage stormwater. My name is Nicole Beck. I'm the principal of Second Nature. I have a PhD in aquatic chemistry, and I have made it my academic and career mission to really figure out how to bring science to policy and decision makers.
I'm Gary Conley, senior scientist at Second Nature. I handle mostly technical developments, background in hydrology, geography, applied math, and I spent the last 10 years working to provide water quality solutions both as an agency staffer and a consultant.
Hi, my name is Donna Myers. I'm with Conservation Collaborative. I work as a consultant to local governments, nonprofits, and am on the project team helping with more of the sort of watershed management perspective, and also the person sort of kind of focusing on sort of the needs of local governments, et cetera, in the process of the products that we'll be talking to you about today. So I'm going to go over just briefly a quick outline of what we'll be talking about today, starting with some big picture reminders of where we are today with regard to stormwater management. Nicole and Gary will get into a lot of specifics about the software and the tool. The bulk of the presentation will be covering those items. We're then going to go into a case study in Pacific Grove that the tool and the software were used to help develop. And finally, we're going to end with questions and answers. We've got quite a lot of time for that. And I want to mention that we do have state board or regional board staff from the Central Coast on the line, as well as stormwater staff from the city of Paso Robles, the city of Santa Cruz, and the city of, city of Santa Cruz on the line. Those folks are familiar with the tool, have been part of a technical advisory committee that's developed the tool over the last 18 months, so some hands-on reflections for folks that have questions will be available through those folks joining us. So real quick, I just kind of want to back up to sort of big picture and why the software and the tool has been in development the last year and a half. And also tie this back to the STORM's mandate, which is really to try to provide additional tools and dialogue and communication around stormwater management statewide. So we're really excited to be here and be presenting today as part of the STORM's series because we feel like this product really fits nicely, or these tools fit very nicely into sort of the STORM's idea of communicating and building a community around stormwater management in the state. Real quickly, let's just take a look at our big picture. We've been going at stormwater for almost two decades now. In the late 90s is when we got sort of final rules, the formal rules from EPA. We in California have largely gone after stormwater through our water bonds and other efforts. We're spending you know, an estimated million, 1 to 1.5 billion annually right now. We are looking at a funding gap annually, though, of about 500 million to 800 million. And even though we've been very successful at getting a lot of good impact out of our water bonds, we're still only spending about 5% of those bonds on stormwater. So monies are going to a lot of other needs in terms of water resource management in California, stormwater being one of those. But certainly funding is one thing I think everyone kind of keeps their eyes on in trying to accomplish the goals around stormwater management in California. At the local level, for those jurisdictions that are able to pass 218 types of funding measures and things like that, at that local level, the local stormwater manager really needs to be able to communicate the benefits back to the voters and back to elected officials and back to the decision makers in their own jurisdictions. And that's one part of what we think the software tool really does effectively. And we'd like to explore that with folks today as you walk through the presentation. But again, it's sort of how do we report that progress? How do we continue to inform the public and decision makers that this is a big problem? It's an expensive problem. But with the right kinds of tools, we can start to move forward and show the benefits, not only within the regulatory community, but actually outside of that to our local towns and communities, and to the voters who support both the state bonds as well as local measures that might support stormwater management in towns. Through both talking with folks and also you know, looking at needs across the stormwater manager's role, we've identified these needs as sort of the primary focus of how we've developed the software tool. So obviously number one in most managers' minds is how do I comply? How do I report? Those kinds of things are extremely important to folks. How do I do that efficiently if I don't have a well-funded program? What is the progress and value that I can express to my community as a stormwater manager or to my public works director or to my city council or my board of supervisors? So that's a need we really want to keep an eye on as well. How can we do this as transparently as possible? Obviously, there's a large audience that is concerned about the quality of our water in California. And we want to be able to develop tools and software that actually can show results and have a level of transparency while at the same time meeting those regulatory requirements, providing a way for each of the regional boards to look at progress across the spectrum, across all regional boards, and all the way down to the stormwater manager or the particular city council person who really takes you know, a great interest in water quality and wants to be able to communicate that to constituencies. So again, how are we making this picture a little bit bigger for more folks involved rather than just managers? And then finally, a little bit about what we just discussed on the last slide is, you know, what does that mean in terms of financial support moving forward for stormwater management in California? We have been a lot in our science and our data collection and our modeling, and a lot of excellent work has been done over the last 15, 20 years in terms of really understanding and identifying not only the issues and the constituents that we need to be looking at, but also we've spent quite a lot of time doing that. And one of the things that we're going to kind of, I guess, sort of discuss today is helping people get ready to do more, to actually do more actions. So with our sort of traditional approach to monitoring and modeling, I think one of our questions is, are we sort of losing the forest through the trees? Because we will never have enough money to do all the science and all the monitoring and all the modeling that we may need to do to give us an answer for absolute improvement. But we do know that we can begin to iteratively improve water quality with the right kind of tools that we can not only share directly with our compliance needs, but also with a broader community of stormwater managers. And that's one of the big things that we're really hoping with the tool and the software is that people see an opportunity to not only work on their own program, but to actually develop a constituency of colleagues that can be talking to one another in terms of the transparency of data and the availability of getting information out and being shared amongst both regional boards as well as individual stormwater managers around the state. And this, in particular, really speaks to Project 3C, which is in the storms report. Our presentation today is directly in response to that description that is included in the storms report. And really what we're looking at is informing decisions, improving effectiveness, and then maximizing outcomes. What we really want to do is move towards actual effective implementation to get us closer to cleaning up our water. And what our tool will do, and you'll see next in the presentation by Nicole and Gary, is three main things. It helps you plan, helps you prioritize, and it'll help you implement. And it does those things based off the three most necessary ingredients we hope to move people towards managing stormwater, which is accessible science, a quantitative iterative approach, and then the flexibility to use this tool to not only accomplish stormwater in the vein that we think about it now, but to actually have it be a tool that could be flexible towards building, that could be flexible enough to build towards other goals that might come from the state in terms of water management in California. So this tool is built such that it is flexible, that it has the ability to sort of morph as our water resource management goals in the state morph over time and our priorities change. So that's just a little bit of a big picture background. I'm going to turn it over to Nicole, and she'll go from there. Thank you.
Set the standard tie here. Okay. I want to acknowledge the funding and the participation of our Central Coast group. We are ending a three-year collaborative effort led by the Central Coast Water Board and their affiliate, the Low Impact Development Initiative. These are the folks that were on our technical advisory committee, and we'll continue to collaborate with them as well as other users as we move forward. My slide's not moving forward. At what? There it is. Can't give this talk without giving a shout out to our partners at the Tahoe Basin. Second Nature, since our inception, has been involved in the Lake Clarity Crediting Program and the tools that are supporting that program now. a lot of lessons learned from that forward thinking and innovative program that's on the ground, and you're going to see a number of the tools that are in the next generation from there. And what we have now is probably a more practical and feasible set of software to help managers and implementers and regulators move forward with managing stormwater. Okay, so a little bit just about the software. This is a homepage. It's a suite of tools. The assessment tools are rapid assessment methods, or RAMs, or what we call them. That's a term that's been around for a while, but these are all custom built and they're specifically designed to evaluate the effectiveness of our actions. A little bit of data is collected over a large area, and it can be repeated objectively. We can train anyone to use these rapid assessments in a day of training, and we focus in on user precision. So me and the guy in the front can go and look at the same place and collect the same data, and we'll get within a 10% of the same answer. The quantification, then, is our tool to estimate load reductions. It's a quantitative model. Lots of models out there, but this one, and Gary will talk a lot about it, simplified, focused, yet scientifically defensible. And these are all built and coded on the web. So they share a back-end database. So the managers are responsible for collecting data through the rapid assessments, and those become inputs into the model. Our approach to these is one of our kind of operating principles at Second Nature, is to know the fate of your data. As a field, we're really good at collecting data. We spend a lot of time collecting data, and we're getting better at managing it, but we don't always think all the way through how we're going to analyze, report it, and use it to answer questions. So we've standardized this from the data collection all the way through to the reporting formats, and then we transparently document all the technical computations and assumptions, et cetera, in technical documents. So that's all available, but it makes it a lot easier to generate consistent and usable data sets. Again, as Donna said, it's driven and focused at making the stormwater manager's job easier by complying by using these tools and demonstrating progress and helping inform their decisions. That's why it's called To Inform. All right, so we operate at three spatial scales. And everything we do is map-based, spatially explicit. So the first is the site scale. This is where we do stuff. We disconnect roof runoff, we street sweep, we put in bioretention systems. That has an impact on an urban catchment scale, the way the water moves through the urban system. So we delineate urban catchments and better understand the way that stormwater is moving through the system. And then we have lots of catchments that represent sub-catchments, or they can be evaluated over an entire municipality, over a larger watershed, state, region, et cetera. We have a scalable unit. So I'm going to go into each of these. So the first, the site scale, right? We do structural or non-structural BMP implementation. And I'm going to, there's a number of these kind of phase two permit sections that are going to pop up on a lot of these. So we are focusing in on meeting the intent of the permits and the sections of the permit without, I have a copy of the permit here, phase two. It's about 500 pages back in front, pretty complicated. But the intent of the permit is right? We know what we need to understand where our water is going. We know what actions we need to implement generally, and we know that those have to be maintained over time. So we've embraced those concepts. All right, so non-structural BMPs, there are a number of things that we call non-structural BMPs. One that we've seen is education and outreach. While that is critical, right, we need to educate folks, it's really hard to quantify the water quality benefits of holding a workshop. But if we have this information in a way that's more accessible, we now can have those workshops generate more response from folks, right? We get a water quality benefit when someone leaves here and goes and disconnects their roof runoff at their house. So the non-structural BMPs that we focus on are parcel runoff controls, which is all the intent of the post-construction requirements and the opportunities, whether it's retrofit or new development. Let's try to retain as much volume as we can and recharge it at the site, restore the hydrologic cycle. And then we have street sweeping, these like incredibly cost-effective mobile BMPs that if we implement them effectively can control a lot of the pollutants that are in the urban environment before they get entrained into our stormwater system. Once they're in our stormwater system, we have to treat them. Those are our structural BMPs. And we break them into two different types, or categories, if you will. We have 14 types, but decentralized are the smaller ones. Bioretention, biofiltration, infiltration features, et cetera. We're very specific about how we, what we call those, how they're defined. So again, two of us can go and look at something and call it, give it a particular type. And then centralized BMPs, the larger capital improvement projects that we're implementing, multi-million dollar projects. So these are the data that are collected, and I'm going to just show you one screenshot of BMPRAM, the Structural BMP Rapid Assessment Method, evaluating the effectiveness of structural BMPs. I could give a, we give talks for an hour on this, so you're going to get 2 minutes. This is the screenshot of this particular tool. It's been around since 2009. It was first developed in the Tahoe Basin, and it came out of us being contracted to go and monitor for a couple of years a few centralized BMPs. And we had automated samplers and continuous hydrology and 8 pollutants. And at the end, we created these really beautiful reports that sit on a shelf, and the report cover sits on our wall. And we popped our head up, and you know, the basin had spent $1 billion. So there are hundreds of them. So how do we spatially extrapolate that information so that we get a little bit knowing where our assets are and generating information that's feasible and informative to maintain them over time? So this is City of Watsonville zoomed in. Each one of those points is a different structural BMP. The ones that are red need maintenance. The ones that are green are in good condition. And the other ones are in somewhere in between. The users go out and they do a series of objective observations that then is, that's our kind of our secret sauce, if you will, again, in our technical document, but what you know makes us excited as scientists, translating those observations into a continuous 0 to 5 scale. It's all quantitative, it's all tracked, This can be handed to the Public Works Department to say, hey, go maintain those red ones. We don't have to maintain every catch basin all the time. We just need to address the ones that are in need of maintenance. Maintain it, go reassess it using the same techniques. Now it turns green, and I have that documented in my data management system. Okay, urban catchment spatial scale. So the initial the population of the model, the stormwater tool to estimate load reductions, is a mapping effort, understanding and delineating the way water runs through the urban environment. There are right answers, it's just that we haven't paid enough attention about how to really map the way that water, our stormwater is being routed. At this scale, there's then a number of attributes that are generated that are inputs to the model, land use, imperviousness, soils, precipitation, et cetera. And we do two scenarios out of the model. The model does it automatically on the web. It's magic. So the first is a baseline where we just have no BMPs. We don't hem and haw about what the condition was 10 years ago, 15 years ago. We just say nothing's been done. We're looking at the imperviousness and its connectivity to the receiving water. That's scenario one. Then we layer the BMPs on top of it, their design specifications and their effectiveness, and we run the model again. Same precipitation, same land use. So the delta now is the effectiveness of our management actions on this catchment scale. We're isolating the signal of the management action. We do that for one catchment, and we just do it over and over and over. And if we call it a common scalable unit. The delta between these two then is our load reduction of the receiving water. What the effectiveness of the municipality has done to reduce the runoff and the particulate pollutants to the receiving water. And we do it to the receiving water for two reasons. The first is it's what the stormwater manager can control. It's directly in their mandate to be able to reduce and mitigate the urban environment. And the second is that it's directly testable. Now we have a prediction of the water quality benefits of these cumulative actions. We can go and now do our water quality monitoring at the outlet of these catchments and test whether or not we have a reduction in the runoff and the loading as a result, above and beyond natural availability as a result of effective actions. Real quickly, we do two pollutants, focus on, see them as powerful surrogates of the majority of urban pollutants, runoff. We don't have urban stormwater runoff coming out of a pipe. The majority of our urban pollutants aren't going to get to the receiving water. And then particulates. And we're happy to talk about those in the Q&A. Okay, so we have that common scalable unit. Now we can do two things with that. We can prioritize, and we can track progress. So this is the prioritization map. This is an example of the city of Watsonville, and it's a hypothetical 2020 and the runoff load out of each one of those catchments divided by the area of the catchment, so it's a runoff rate. They're ranked from high to low, and they're broken into five categories. So the ones that are dark blue here are the ones that have the highest per unit area stormwater runoff generation to the receiving water. Or on the flip side, the opportunity to treat stormwater as a resource. And we gave this map, Dave Licaro is on the phone from Paso Robles, and he said, oh, that kind of jives with what I thought. So he's the expert in Paso Robles, and we've now generated these prioritization maps using an objective technique, and it aligns with the expert's opinion. But now he also has a map by which he can show to his city council, to his funders, to his regional partners as to where the priorities are to now evaluate and investigate what they can do at that localized scale. Where are the opportunities now for, is it recharge? Is it downstream, in-stream flows and habitat? We now have a spatial mapping of the spatial priorities. And this is iteratively generated over and over as actions are implemented. All right. The second then is to quantify and track progress. So this is also the homepage has that map and this histogram, and we do them for both particulates and runoff. I'm showing you the runoff one here. So this is a temporal histogram, a quantified tracking and reporting of the progress. The height of the bar is the baseline load or the load with no BMPs. the height of the dark brown blue bar is the current load. If we had all the BMPs in there, what's our loading out of the model now? So then the baby blue becomes our program effectiveness, our progress. This is showing a pretty optimistic program for Watsonville, which we like to be optimistic. So, but it provides a unit of acre feet per year on an average annual basis that is being retained on the landscape and not being discharged to the receiving water. Oh, showing the arrows. Okay, sorry. And then lastly, before I give it to Gary, he's going to go into a little bit more about the model. How do they comply? So what we are, we have about 20 Central Coast municipalities onboarded and just getting going on using the software. The Central Coast Regional Board, to evaluate compliance, will have a read-only access to annual records. So the municipalities will do their rapid assessments, they'll generate their model results, iteratively use that over the year. When they're done, they lock it, are you sure, I'm positive. They can't change the previous year's data, and the regional board has read-only access. They can evaluate progress, and if they have questions, they have a conversation. Okay, Gary, you're up.
So Donna's told you a bit about why we're working on this stuff, and Nicole just told you a lot about what the primary functionality of the tools are, and I'm going to tell you something about how we build them in terms of the fundamental concepts that underlie the development of the Teller stormwater model. Some of the data and graphics that I'll be talking about are presented in a peer-reviewed journal article in Journal of Environmental Management that's listed at the bottom of the slide that's currently in press. We've taken a pretty deliberate tack in our development of Teller to make sure that the tool that we're building lines up with the job that it's meant to do. The job at hand is to help stormwater managers prioritize actions and to track progress over the time. The idea being to put a usable tool into the hands of the people that are in a position on the ground to make decisions that are actually going to affect water quality. We need it to be robust to scrutiny, and we want it to be as transparent as possible. We also want those people using the model to understand where their estimates are coming from. To those ends, we also try to make it as simple as possible or only as complex as necessary. It helps with transparency, makes it easier to use, and it also helps to reduce uncertainty in model outputs that can be associated with extraneous model components. The idea that the most complex, sophisticated model you can possibly design is the best alternative has been sort of a sticky paradigm to get out of. And the truth is that's simply not the case. It just depends on the application that you're using the model for. National Research Council way back in 2007 actually provides guidance that for the purposes of practical application in stormwater, you probably shouldn't throw every bit of understanding about how the system works into your model just because you can. And the reason that you shouldn't is because it can reduce our capacity to test hypotheses about, for instance, what impact a set of BMPs are having in the stormwater system. What happens is these extraneous model components that might not be sensitive to the inputs end up interacting with one another. And so the outputs that you get on the other side aren't just a result of the inputs going in, they're also a result of those interactions that you simply may not understand very well. The graphic on the other side of the slide sort of illustrates this concept wherein we have increasing model complexity on the x-axis and uncertainty on the y-axis. as you include more and more detail about the system in the model, uncertainty associated with that structure decreases. That's the green line on the graphic. The trouble being to support all of that complex structure and parameterization, you tend to need more data to verify those model components. So the uncertainty associated with those data goes up. Up till now, the idea has been mostly to get as far to the right on the green line as possible, but that's probably not really the best approach. The best approach is more to find that sweet spot right in the middle, such that the data that are most commonly available to your users align with the degree of complexity or detail that you actually include in the model. So that's what we've tried to do with Teller, is to hit that sweet spot. Understanding changes in any natural system are always difficult for one really important reason, that there's always other sources of variability that tend to be changing what you're interested in measuring. For instance, in a stormwater system, rainfall is different from year to year. It makes it difficult to know exactly how much good your BMPs are doing from year to year. There's a couple different ways to handle this. It can be done explicitly by tracking individual storms over time, or it can be done implicitly, and this is how we do it in Teller, by characterizing the distribution of storms that are likely to occur in a region. So the way that we do it in Teller is we take a 30-year rainfall distribution that's interpolated, it's the PRISM data set out of University of Oregon, so it's interpolated rainfall data, and we create a subset of metrics that characterize that distribution that are adjusted for their frequency of occurrence and the number of rain days that happen per year. We simulate runoff for each of those events. And so the result being that instead of, for say, a 30-year time frame, you would need 262,000 calculations if you're simulating hourly in a continuous simulation model. We only have to do 4. So that's quite a bit less, and it offers a number of advantages, mostly computational, which means you don't have to have a stormwater model sitting spinning away for an afternoon on one person's desk. It could run almost instantaneously via the web, and it also makes it a lot easier to share the data and outputs amongst practitioners when it's running on the web that way. So we like that. We're not really trying to reinvent the wheel with Teller here, mostly because there's already lots of real good wheels out there. We use publicly available data that's been around for a long time to characterize the land use, impervious coverage, the soil type. The algorithms that generate runoff and do the routing are from the USDA and the NRCS. And what we're trying not to do is create a false degree of precision by including elements in the model that we definitely can't characterize with readily available data sets. Lots of continuous models might include something like spatially distributed soil hydraulic conductivity or depression storage, and I would argue that those things, you know, in a spatial context are simply unknowable, and no one will ever have the data to reliably parameterize those elements of a model. So in that way, we try to align the complexity of the input data with those data that are readily available to practitioners, and hopefully the result of that is we retain a good deal of capacity in the model to test hypotheses about effectiveness of BMPs or anything else we want to test about stormwater, because we've reduced the uncertainty that would come with not being able to specify those data or a required calibration procedure. One of the key inputs that I didn't mention on the other slide is the BMPs that that Nicole was talking about. The way that we characterize benefits from BMPs is with sequential explicit routing, both within catchments and amongst catchments. So that if you're receiving water downstream, what you feel in terms of the impacts from your stormwater and the benefits from reductions from BMPs is the cumulative effect of everything that happened upstream. So water moves from non-structural BMPs like street sweeping or routing from rooftops to pervious areas in an LID scenario. From there to decentralized BMPs, so small bioswales and porous pavement, things like that. And from there, within a catchment, into larger centralized BMPs, like a big dry basin or a wet basin or something. So once you leave that catchment, you have all of those reductions associated with your stormwater, and you move to the next catchment on and onward until you finally get to your receiving water. Of course, none of this really means very much unless we can rely on the estimates that come out. So we have some validation that we do for the model. The graphic on the screen right now is showing the problem with doing this sort of validation often with stormwater models is that these data are just really difficult to come by. The data are so flashy. Unless you're collecting at 10-minute intervals, you're really likely to miss some components of the hydrograph. So they're not easy to find. Fortunately, as part of the Lake Clarity crediting program in the Lake Tahoe region, we were able to install a number of continuous samplers both at the inlets and the outlets of structural BMPs in a number of different urbanized catchments around the Tahoe Basin. And so we monitored these we have 3 years of continuous data, which helped us out a lot in this instance. On the vertical axis is the teller estimated runoff. On the horizontal axis is the observed runoff. So you can, and the one-to-one line is right in the center of the graph. So you can see we see generally good correspondence. The average percent bias is 14% between the observed, so that would be a systematic difference between the observed and the model flows. The Nash Sutcliffe efficiency measure, it's like a hydrologic version of the R squared, is fantastic. It's 0.97. Of course, that's pretty strongly affected by Eloise Basin at the top corner of the graph there. But if we remove that even, we still see that most of the variance across the region in the observed annual flows are explained by Teller, with 0.88 NSC, or 88% of variance explained. So good initial validation experiment results. I was talking at the beginning the difference between the Teller approach and a more complex continuous simulation approach. We wanted to compare the two and see how Teller stacked up, not just to the observed data, but what you would get out of a continuous simulation model. So we compared it to a swim-based model. In this case, it's the National Stormwater Calculator, and just made a series of hypothetical catchments with, varied the soil types and the rainfall and the areas and whatnot, so that we had 40 of those and looked at what the differences were. The result that you can see in the histogram is that we're nearly always within 10% of one another between, that's the difference on the x-axis. So we're nearly always within 10% of one another, and the average, or the most likely difference that you would get between Teller and a swim-based or probably another continuous simulation model, is about 2.3%, right? So, sorry, just don't want to forget to say something. So that's what we want to see. When we're speaking about the benefits of a simpler model, when we have comparable performance to a continuous simulation model, those benefits become really valuable. Here's another example of a comparison. This time it's PLRM, the pollutant load reduction model that was built and calibrated specifically for the Tahoe Basin. Again, the one-to-one line in the center, telepredictions on the y-axis. And we see the same thing, good correspondence between this swim-based model and the teller predictions. The really big difference between the way that these two different predictions were generated is the time that it takes to make them. Once the data is compiled, creating these estimates via PLRM takes about 40 hours worth of work because it's just a more complex model to deal with. Doing it via teller took me 4. So that's a pretty good time benefit that we're getting, in addition to, you know, the other benefits that we get with a simpler model. It's more transparent, it's easier to use, and also we probably reduce the uncertainty associated with insensitive model components and hence retain a greater capacity to test hypotheses and heuristic measurement scenarios. The continuous simulation models are fantastic tools, especially for understanding the dynamics of how these stormwater systems work. It's just that for this specific application, for the purpose that we need the tool for, the benefits of the simpler model are often gonna trump the resolution that you get with the continuous simulation model. I think Nicole now is gonna give us a practical example of the use of teller.
All right, so real quick to wrap up the case study. So City of Pacific Grove and the City of Monterey, they are both onboarded onto the program, which means that they did their mapping, they delineated their catchments and generated a number of land use attributes. They also both drain to a ASBS area, which the in this map, the Monterey Bay Aquarium is at the bottom there, so it's a really beautiful part of California coastline. We're just going to show how they used reprocessing the data. So there's, I think, a handful, maybe 3 or 4 Monterey catchments in here, and then half of Pacific Grove. The urban greening plan and a number of other plans are being developed to do a big funding and implementation push in this area under the ASBS requirements. So now with this new polygon or new drainage area, we can generate a baseline load, both particulates and volumes. I'll show the others in a second, by this collaboration across the two different municipalities. So they have different baseline loads within their municipalities. We see this as a pretty neat application for regional watershed planning as well as stormwater resource planning, et cetera. So then the engineers and the landscape architects go away and they have dozens of different types of structural and non-structural BMPs. Really cool, beautiful plan. This is an example of a bioretention system that they put in. And in order to do their costs, they have to define the drainage area and then right size the volumes to the 85th percentile storm, et cetera. So we took that information across all the BMPs that they had implemented or were planning to implement in this plan. The little light white dots, hopefully you all can see, are decentralized BMPs, and then the gray polygons are the centralized. It's upwards of a $10 million 10-year phased plan. And they gave us the information we needed, and then what we did is, what if we implemented all of those with their location within the catchments, that they, again, used the prioritization map to figure out where to put these, and came up with these planned future scenarios. So these can be seen as water quality objectives, right? This is the next 10 years of what this group is going to be working on. A 23% reduction in stormwater runoff to the ASBS and nearly a 60% reduction in the particulate loading. becomes pretty powerful to give to funders. And so now let's fast forward to 2025. Say they've implemented all of these as designed, they're on the ground, they're using the same tool to now inventory and assess these different structural and non-structural BMPs that have gone in. And May 2025, May is our recommendation on an annual basis to do your BMP assessments and inventory, right? Everything right now is getting hammered. So we're gonna have to do a lot of maintenance this year. So intern or the trained RCD or whoever it is goes out, does the assessments. And if you'll notice in this current year, at the bottom, we haven't quite achieved the objective. And you can notice two of the centralized BMPs that are really critical to the water quality performance of this area are not performing. The manager can see this, see the load reduction estimates, decide to do maintenance, and then once they're done, turns green, save it, give it to the regulator, and even report back to their funders.
Yeah, and I'll jump in here. I mean, this case study is great in that it not only shows, you know, if you're looking at some zoning changes locally in your city or your county, those kinds of rule changes just within your own municipality, but also just this larger reporting and ability to be competitive at stormwater grants when they're available. So as we sort of go through these dips and highs and lows of funding, being able to have this tool in place and to be able to kind of hit that sweet spot where you can put together a competitive grant package, but also have a surety that you can do some reporting on the back end, because most grants now are requiring, you know, 15, 20 year requirements in terms of making sure the improvements are maintained and working. This kind of reporting is very effective and transparent, which is a benefit to the stormwater managers, certainly.
All right, so that, should wrap up. Again, happening now, looking forward to collaborating with our current users and have had some interest outside of the Central Coast, and ready for questions. Oh, I think they got a mic back here.
Hi. Thanks for presenting this to us. I manage a grant program here at the Water Boards. It's the Clean Water Act Section 319 grant program. And so we focus on storm water pollution from non-urban sources. And so the examples that you gave seem focused on urban areas. Would this tool be applicable to non-urban areas? And what size? So it looks like you're focusing on catchments. Could it be expanded to larger watershed areas?
It's a question we get a lot. Yes, this first effort is focused specifically on stormwater and the municipal stormwater permit. If you go to tooinform.com, we also have a watershed management portion. And we are interested in expanding this to the watershed scale. I mean, that's obviously where we need a holistic watershed approach. There's more pieces to that puzzle, and it's also more political. So one of our, at least, desires now is to demonstrate this works, that this is a sound process and software platform that can iteratively manage, prioritize, track, and implement. But there's, from our perspective on a technical side, there's no reason why it can't go to the watershed scale, and stay tuned, because that's what we're working on.
And just so you know, we're constantly trying to figure out how to better prioritize our funding and then also evaluate effectiveness of our projects. So.
Yeah, I will say that the maps, the prioritization maps in the urban environment, the unit of acre feet per year should mean something in an integrated watershed or water management realm. And we see that as, at least at a spatial scale, that overlaying with multi-benefits of downstream in stream habitat, for example, climate resilience, recharge zones, et cetera, like a lot of the same kind of principles apply, and we're at least starting to think more on a spatial transparent scale. We're working with the SLO County regions and their stormwater resource plans, and that's actually in our scope, is to help them think on a larger watershed scale. So we're going there, yeah.
Hi, this is a good, this looks very promising. I was curious, you had mentioned spatially distributed soil, you know, being excluded from this, but I'm imagining that the NRCS hydrologic soil group is used for the curve number generation. Okay, so then you at least have the KSAT values at disposal. I was wondering if that's being incorporated, or because sometimes bioretention needs that higher infiltration rate to be effective, and is that incorporated into the program, or is it more incorporated into the observations?
The input data. The program uses those NRCS soil classifications as input data. The SEF curve number is how runoff is generated, and so that incorporates the infiltration ability of those soils.
And then when they size for the bioretention, right, they have to account for their local characteristics and do their engineering design. So if they don't have amiable soils, right, they're going to have to, but theoretically, the design should create a larger storage volume. Either way, the capacity of the BMP is explicitly put into the model.
The point, I guess the point that I was sort of getting at was that we're probably more sure that 100-acre catchment is primarily NRCS soil type D than we know about differences in soil hydraulic conductivity from 1 meter grid cell to the next meter grid cell or something like that, yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
Okay, so before we get to the next question, I just want to acknowledge that we have some folks on the phone who will be helping us answer some questions. And we have Dominic Rocks from Region 3, Dave Lacaro from the City of Paso Robles, Agnes Topp from the City of Santa Cruz, and Tricia Wanton from the City of Monterey. And I will now unmute you.
No questions. I was going to chime in with one. Just thinking about how cities nowadays have a portal for reporting just general issues, you know, for nuisances. I was just wondering, you know, is there a way for this to be open to public input for a stormwater related issue related to a BMP, or is it going to be solely relying on stormwater staff?
From our perspective, that's why we have stakeholders and this collaborative process. I don't know that that's our decision to make. I think that's the cities and the regulators and decide whether or not, you know, what the pros and cons are of that. But there's no reason from our perspective that wouldn't be a publicly available information or portions of it publicly available if that seems to be beneficial. Maybe one of our stormwater managers could chime in on that one.
This is David Lacaro. I want to make sure I understand the question, but when I first heard it sounded to me it was using the module as some sort of a complaint type of filing deal on a specific BMP. Is that the way I understood it?
I would agree. So I guess you had us to reiterate what I was saying. You know, I can go to the city of Sacramento and say there's someone dumped trash illegally here, or someone, you know, there's a broken irrigation head that belongs to the city. If you were to make a portal directed towards stormwater, someone could observe flooding in a certain area, or they might recognize that a BMP is not operating
correctly.
Thank you. Yeah, that's what I understood. You know, we do have a separate mechanism to track some problematic BMPs or illicit discharges or whatnot. We've got a hotline. We also have the ability to track a lot of those online. So if you're on an email and you were to do that, so we have a separate module. You know, I'm looking at this more of what Second Nature has put together here as really kind of a bigger picture type of an approach, aside from, you know, tracking BMPs specifically for, you know, whether they're problematic or illicit discharges and so forth. So looking at what Nicole had put together, she showed a slide there where it kind of highlighted areas that had higher hydrologic loading or just runoff loading and then particulate loading. And so from a programmatic standpoint, I mean, it makes sense that we start to focus our funds, our limited funds, as you've talked to, I'm sure, a lot of program stormwater program managers, we've got a limited amount of resources to tap into to then implement some BMPs. So now we have this excellent opportunity to take a look at this map geospatially and really fine-tune the discussion on these catchments that we're starting to see with higher contribution to receiving water, right? So now we can say, okay, out of the 100 catchments that we find within our city boundaries, we find that a majority of them, and let's just say, 10 of them, really beg the question, well, what are we doing in those areas? What can we implement in those areas to then improve, water quality in those areas with respect to particulate, or minimizing, retaining some of that runoff so that we minimize the amount of runoff contribution to receiving water. So it's really a tool that helps us focus in our limited resources to those areas. So that's really how I see this with respect to BMP implementation and understanding the effectiveness of those BMPs, rather than a complaint kind of filing mechanism.
This is Dominic Rock at the Central Coast Regional Water Quality Control Board, and I would just jump on what Dave said about being able to focus the effort and really get it, what's going to make a difference in terms of on-the-ground activity. The delineation of the catchments within the cities is a huge, huge step forward from where most of our phase two communities were just even 2 years ago. So creating that kind of it's a reductionist approach, but you got to have it. You've got to look at a city in a more refined way than just throwing your minimum control measures out there and hoping they work. You've got to look at where they're happening on the ground. So I think the key here is that this model really is a tool that people like Dave Lucaro at Paso Robles, Agnes at Santa Cruz, and elsewhere can actually get into the process of evaluating this stuff on a more tangible, spatially explicit level. And, you know, the other thing is we might discover that there are many parts of cities that don't require much attention, that, you know, even the nominal street sweeping is not necessarily contributing that much because of the hydrologic connectivity of a particular catchment to receiving water. So this is just a huge step forward in having that spatially relevant information in the hands of the stormwater manager. And I just feel like the tool, you know, obviously we were committed, involved in developing it, but I really do think it came out at that right level, that sweet spot, you know, between complexity and simplicity, and between having a coherent outcome that you can share with people, you know, graphically, what's important within the watershed or within the city. So that's just a pitch. I do think a lot of folks are probably wondering how you can conduct this evaluation or, you know, conduct stormwater management effectively if you don't have an understanding of specific pollutants like, you know, copper or, you know, pesticides or something like that. And it might be something one of the program developers want to address, but just from a regulatory perspective, my perspective, we're not quite at that place where we need to know a whole suite of parameters, fate and transport in the watersheds in our urban catchments. We need to have a basic understanding of pollutant transport and volume and runoff volume generated by our urban catchments. And this tool is really going to deliver that, and it will set us up to do those more explicit and refined analyses later on. So, but if Nicole or somebody wants to address the multiple pollutants, it'd be maybe a good opportunity for that.
This is Agnes with the City of Santa Cruz. Just to address your public outreach sort of question, I envision the model or the mapping anyway, potentially being helpful for public outreach, where it provides more of a visual for us to communicate with the public, more so than the public communicating to us, because we already have those tools sort of available. I can say that I've used the map that we generated with the catchments in a public event that we had, and it did generate quite a bit of interest with people trying to figure out, you know, which catchment their house was in, and therefore figuring out which creek it actually flows to. And I think it just sort of helps educate the public.
This is David LaCaro again. One other point that was brought up and kind of went through, and this really just piggybacks on Agnes there, is the fact that, you know, this is a big opportunity to communicate. And so one of the things that we run into with challenge is to communicate this adequately to our city council members, to our public. And so when it comes down to looking at projects that we know are going to be beneficial in certain areas of the city, you know, we have something that's going to effectively communicate, okay, well, we see that, you know, let's say a detention basin in this certain area is really going to do the trick or could potentially minimize the amount of contribution going and receiving water. So, you know, that's another factor, too, is being able to communicate effectively where the funding is going to go. So it almost kind of brings back the sense of accountability for the program. Instead of doing a shotgun approach, we're really focusing in on where the funding is going and how it's being used.
Any more questions?
I have one question, and I think Dominic was alluding to it a little bit more. Can you talk a little bit more about why you use particulates for your surrogate for pollutant load reduction calculations?
Yeah. I'll do the high level, and then I'll let Gary go into a little more detail. First is just to simplify communication, right? When we generate these reports and we have 8 different pollutants that have variability in the outputs, in our opinion, that variability is driven by the way the data is collected. The second is that the stormwater actions that are effective for particulates and volume are effective for the majority of the pollutants that we're talking about in the urban environment. The fate and transport, they're hydrophobic. They like to adhere to soil particles. They are retained very efficiently in the soil horizon if you can infiltrate volumes and or if you can settle particles. So that basic premise on just the fate and transport, we don't have a copper groundwater problem. We don't have a copper phosphorus problem. Nitrate's a different issue, but I'll argue that the urban environment is not our primary source of nitrate in our receiving waters.
So that's a good reason. There's 2 other good reasons, I think. The first is that there's a good deal of evidence supporting correspondence between pollutants, even in some cases in the dissolve phase, correspondence between those and TSS. The Southern California Coastal Water Research Project has done a phenomenal amount of work in Los Angeles area to probably about 10 years ago now to show those relationships. And secondly, it sort of aligns with our philosophy of only including a degree of complexity in the model that can be reliably supported by the data available. The sources that we spent actually quite a lot of time on this to try to pin it down, and you know, we did a literature review, even a review of the literature reviews, trying to characterize specific land use concentrations of different pollutants. We have our own data sets from the Central Coast and the Tahoe Basin, and we mined the national BMP database. So with that three-pronged approach, what we came up with was that for individual pollutants in specific catchments, the concentrations are all over the map, mostly because people don't always know what's going on in the catchment that they're monitoring downstream from. There's variations in the condition of different types of land use that would cause different pollutant production potential. Also, people define land use in slightly different ways from one circumstance to another. And TSS is that parameter that's been measured most often, and at least we can find some degree of consistency from one land use to another, if not in their absolute values, often in the ordering of the magnitude of concentrations from one land use type to another. And in fact, I've looked at other approaches that have tried to do multi-pollutant modeling. Sometimes what I've found is that while the actual absolute numbers are different for individual pollutants, when I've done just correlation plots between them in TSS, they correspond almost one-to-one perfectly. So the idea is we're trying not to present a degree of false precision that doesn't actually exist, you know, and that goes along with the transparency of the model.
I noticed you had a trash component that was accessible. I wanted to know if your model, that's going to be a priority for a lot of the MS4s now coming up, especially I'm coming from a phase 2 MS4. And so I wanted to know how that trash component fit with your other component. Is this something you can lay over the top of it? And what kind of inputs are you going to need for the trash component to show the full capture? And how would an MS4 access your model to look at it and review it?
If you click on the trash RAM icon, it says coming soon. So we know it's a big deal. I sat through a lot of CASQA trash sessions and heard from a number of municipalities that when they do the math in the track one full capture device implementation, just really isn't fiscally feasible. And from our perspective of doing a lot of monitoring and modeling of stormwater BMPs may cause a lot of other issues that we're not thinking about. So our concept of the trash rapid assessment, we're starting to collect data sets, and we'll be working with our users collaboratively. The idea is that we can create a objective on-land visual assessment, like kind of the ideas that are out there right now, but using more of our mantra of spatially explicit and a series of objective observations that generate the results either on the land or in the receiving water. We operate from this place of a land condition standard. It's a lot of what the RoadRAM concept is. The desired land condition is no trash on the urban landscape. So we think that's actually not that hard to observe. It's just a matter of being able to do it such that the data that we collect at the site scale can be scaled. BMP RAM right now, so that's are we effective at the controls, whatever those controls may be. We don't chase all the different practices What we want to do is leave the flexibility of what is done to the municipalities or the implementers or the educators or whatever it is, but we want no trash on the landscape or in our receiving waters. BMP-RAM right now has, when they inventory their BMPs, any inlet can be designated as a trash capture device, and every single one of those inlets has a drainage area. That's a critical input from our perspective because that's going to size what the BMP is. So we can aggregate that now for every catchment, and we know what the area of imperviousness that's being treated by a trash capture device. So long answer is we are working through it, and we're going to work collaboratively with the regulators. And you know, we've put Dominic's toes to the fire a little bit of, will you listen and give us your feedback? But we want to try and find something that's practical for the municipalities but meets the intent of the regulatory requirements.
Okay, so we have a question from a webcast viewer. Is the volume reduction calculated strictly based on model output? Is there any field verification of the BMPs and how they are performing?
Well, we have that capacity. We need the measurements. What the field what the field measurements are happen in BMP-RAM, which is a set of, like Nicole described, standardized observations that we've, in development of BMP-RAM, have strong association to BMP performance in terms of infiltration and pollutant removal. So that's what we're relying on for the for those trajectories, those field observations of the BMP condition. In model development, we did do that that verification in those Tahoe basins that I described, where we had data. That's exactly what we did do. We verified that the model was I didn't show slides about this. About this result, but we verified that the model was showing the proper proportioning of flows to bypass infiltrated and treated flows, and that's also included in the peer-reviewed publication, Journal of Environmental Management. But we're always open to further validation studies if somebody has those data lying around.
I've been asked this question of should we be doing more centralized or structural BMP monitoring. The answer is yes. I think that those are really useful from a quantitative perspective. But what the challenge has been is that we don't understand the condition of the BMP that we're evaluating. Is it operating as designed, and thus we're measuring its kind of optimal performance and load reductions, volume and load reductions, or is it somewhere on that degraded trajectory? And we did a synthesis in the Tahoe Basin right after kind of our first handful of high-resolution studies, because they had paid a bunch of different groups to do these studies. And what came back was from every single researcher was, it would have been great to monitor these things if they had been maintained before we started, because they were choked with material, or they weren't getting water, or they were choked with vegetation. So a lot of the, when we went into the BMP database, that's the National Stormwater BMP database, it's a huge resource. There's a lot of variability in the performance by different BMP types, and I think a lot of that variability has to do with, there's a lot of variability in the condition of those BMPs, so we can better understand their performance and their decline trajectories.
You're on record.
Yeah, I was wondering about the international database of BMPs. Are you tied into it at all? I mean, obviously you'll be collecting some data. Are you contributing to that? If you implement the system, are you feeding back to that resource at all?
I don't think
Well, because it's more sure, specific,
we're
probably.
We're collecting data in the same formats. We did. There's a lot of our Tahoe high-resolution work and Central Coast stuff that we've put in over the years. We try to, you know, we're not leading a lot of those projects anymore because we've been focusing in on trying to create something where we can get a little bit of information over a large area and the rapid assessment stuff. But I think there is a pretty critical future in one, defining the terms. I mean, again, at CASQA this year, just the definition of what the difference is between biofiltration and bioretention was a little fuzzy. And we've been defining that for a few years now, where biofiltration doesn't have any volume loss, whereas bioretention does. Very simple, just being standardized in how we define land uses and BMP types will help us really go a long way, I think.
Okay, another question. Can we share our load reduction data, such as import or export, to their database? We collect this information for 319H grants and could share.
Can you repeat that again, Charlie?
They're asking if they can share the load reduction data, or is it easy to, or can they import or export it to a database?
Oh.
Yeah, yeah. So all data is owned by the municipalities and the users. Data can be exported. Actually, the spatial layers will come back out. So once the mapping and GIS, land use, all that, that can be exported at any time, as well as any of the model outputs. You don't get the great inner, right, the flexibility and the information management of the platform, but you can see all the data either in a spreadsheet or on a map if you use GIS.
And that's really the idea, that the stormwater manager is the modeler, and so they have access to all the input data, all the estimates over time, anything that is going to help them make better decisions.
Hello? Do your models or any of your documentation go into selecting, identifying, or prioritizing projects, or do you leave that up to the municipalities? Do your models or any documentation you have provide guidance on where you should put a BMP, centralized or decentralized BMP, how you select that, how you prioritize all those different projects?
Right. So what comes out, right, are those prioritized maps. We're not engineers. Well, we won't pretend to be engineers. We're not being prescriptive. So now, within those opportunities, and we had this discussion with Dave, the prioritized collection of urban catchments rise to the top. Now, with his local knowledge and with his engineers, they can decide what types of implementation make sense based on land availability, access, public, you know, I mean, they have a number of considerations to do the design and implementation. And like the example we gave for the Pacific Grove ASBS, once they actually do that design and they do it to a level that they are getting cost estimates, they have enough information for us to now be able to, or for the stormwater manager, to be able to model the water quality benefits of those. So it becomes one more piece of information to inform alternative evaluation of different types of implementation.
But we think the fact that it's, you know, that it's all the data that comes in and out is spatial really lends itself to this framework for making those decisions. It's not the answer, but it's a pretty big important piece of the puzzle. We did a project to look at prioritization using groundwater connectivity spatial data, and it was a really neat output where you have the map that Nicole showed with prioritized catchments based on their relative runoff, and then another map that shows connectivity to groundwater, and now you have a map that shows you your groundwater recharge potential in catchments, right, which is a pretty powerful piece of information when you're trying to make decisions about where to put things, if you want to include multi-benefits other than stormwater reduction and water quality improvement.
This iterative approach, you know, so maybe you have your own funding that you can pull out some capital for a while, but you know you have to do a centralized BMP build out that participation. And then again, understand when you've got to either put that in your budget for your CIP as a manager, or, you know, go for a stormwater grant. You know, so it's sort of, instead of being reactionary, you're much more proactive in that. And your planning horizon gets more predictable, rather than sort of just, you know, jumping in because there's a funding opportunity. So, you know, it's that iterative sort of transparency, that investment, and then being able to track the investment time.
Okay, one more question. Sounds as though the initial SWT teller is comprehensive urban pollutant model for direct use by municipal stormwater management. Do you see applicability to a DOT MSR?
I'll talk to the Tahoe program because they've had to work, right, catchments, crosscut, Caltrans and dot roads, et cetera. So it's created a collaborative relationships with the Department of Transportation's and the municipal stormwater managers. And they actually share information and data within those catchments, and then they can parse out what are the water quality benefits associated with road management versus, or primary road management, high traffic road management versus the other land uses within the parcel, or sorry, within the catchment. So it allows the flexibility, and it's certainly addressing and evaluating the generation and opportunities for pollutant reduction on highways and DOT lands, and again, gets everybody talking to each other and looking at the same information on a spatial basis.
All right, I think that ends our seminar series for today. Thanks, Nicole, Gary, and Donna, and thank you everyone for attending.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks. That was great.